community bond committee meetings. Yes, please give yourselves a round of applause for being here. Civic engagement is what makes our city work, so thank you for showing up tonight. I am Brian Dillard. I'm the co-chair for the Parks and Recreation Bond Committee, and my fellow co-chair is Luisa Casso, who is getting love from the audience. And I do want to let everybody know we have Spanish interpretation tonight. Claudia? And Claudia, I'll let you go ahead and...
Buenas tardes. Si alguien necesita servicios de traducción para escuchar el programa de bonos del 2017, puede ir a la parte de atrás y tomar audífonos para escuchar el programa en español. Gracias.
Before we move on, I do want to... So, can everyone outside hear me as well? Because I can hear you. just throughout tonight's meeting, if everybody outside, if you want to reprimand anybody out there for getting a little too loud, feel free to. All right. I'm sure you've all seen me walk out quite a few times during these meetings. That's usually what I'm doing. So we also have three representatives from each of our 10 city council districts on the Parks and Recreation Committee, and they are appointed by each of their respective city council members. So the first part of tonight's meeting will include a presentation from city staff Mike Christie. He's the city engineer and director of transportation and capital improvements department. It will include a follow-up of new projects presented by residents attending the past two meetings. Mike will go over the scope and estimated cost for these new projects. Additionally, last week, city staff sent all committee members a survey to get the committee's input on projects to tour. Mike Ridley will provide a recommendation with the results from this survey. So you probably got that email this week asking about which parks you want to tour through. So we'll be getting the results of that. After Mike's presentation, we'll have 20 minutes allocated for committee members' discussion. So tonight is the last of our citizens to be heard, so we want to make sure that we give the public enough time to get their voices out and heard by us. The rest of the meeting will be dedicated to citizens to be heard, as this is the last meeting that residents will have an opportunity to provide input. The last two meetings will be dedicated to committee discussion of the proposed projects. So the last two meetings are going to be committee work. So this is the time we get to get together and work as a team. If you brought materials with you, citizens of America, if you brought materials with you, staff will be passing those out to the committee members on your behalf. If you did not submit your materials when you signed up to speak, we ask that you please provide those items to staff at this time. If you have staff in the room, can you raise your hands to let folks know? Okay, so I got a hand back there, another hand there. Okay, thank you. Persons or organizations must sign in person by 6:30 p.m. in order to be recognized to speak, and it is currently 6:15. Persons registered to speak must be present in order to give their time to another registered speaker. So I can't have folks come up to me and tell me, hey, so-and-so left, but they told me I could have their time. No time may be given to a person not registered to speak. Persons or organizations must sign in person by 6:30 p.m. Let me repeat that. We will be calling the names of three speakers at a time, allowing speakers to be ready to present. Prior to beginning your comments, we ask that each speaker please state their name and the subject that they will be addressing. So if you're coming up here to speak on a certain park, state your name and the park. And honestly, let's do name, district, and park, please. It helps the committee greatly when you do that. If you brought materials with you, staff will be passing those out to committee members on your behalf again. So without further ado, Mike, if you want to do your presentation.
Good evening, co-chairs, committee members, and lots of community members. It's great to have you all. This is exactly what we've been hoping for. It was great attendance at these committee meetings. We've had over 800 people show up for the meetings amongst the five different committees. So yeah, a round of applause for the group. And we know people are passionate about parks and recreation. So what we want to do is a very short staff presentation, turn it back to you all as a committee, and then I have plenty of time. We know a lot of people have signed up to speak tonight, so we'll want to get to those quickly. So, if I can get this working for starters. Okay, so we have just three things we want to touch on. In front of you is a list in green here. These are the projects that are the new projects. Does everybody should have that in the binder? Not legal. Yeah, it is right there. It says unfunded projects. So these are the ones that were not part of the staff recommendations. But they are definitely for you to consider. There are people have signed up to speak about these projects. I'm just going to speak to them by name, and then I'm going to go into the scope. You have the scope information there, and you have a requested dollar amount there as well. Some of them don't have a dollar amount because the person that spoke about the project didn't have a specific dollar amount associated with that. But we have the Old Spanish Trail Soccer Complex, Dawson Park, John James Park, this is the access to Cole High School, Martin Luther King Plaza, Pitt and Sullivan Park, Davis Scott YMCA, Athletic Court Lighting, Phase 2 YMCA Master Plan, that's the swimming pool, the Stinson Park 5 Diamond Parking Lot Paving, Rainbow Hills Gymnasium, Baseball Park at Five Palms, Gateway Terrace Subdivision, Normal Park Senior Softball League, District 6 Aiden Skate Park, Piper Meadows Homeowners Association New Park, and then Monticello Park as well. So those are all for your consideration through this process. The next one, let's go to the next one.
Quick question. Mike, would you clarify the total amount requested that those line items, that is what was requested in the presentation was given, is that correct?
Right, that was where the owner of that project that brought that project forward provided the number.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we're going to open it up to the committee after a bit, so let me just knock out two more items for you and then turn it back to the committee. So I think you all are going to set a record for tour responses to the survey. You've done a great job. We had 27 responses out of the 32 committees. So if you're in your math, that's 81%. We'll let you know if anybody beats you on that. But that's a great turnout for that. And we want to share the results here. So the first question was select one of the dates which you would like to take the tour. So the at 56%, we had the Saturday, December 3rd. So that's really good timing for it. And so that's, and that looks like, as we look at the other committees too, that'll be a tour Saturday, multiple committees touring like that day. So that's what we'd be looking to do. So mark that on your calendar, Saturday, December 3rd. You'll get a lot more information about that date and time and so forth. We also asked you what projects do you want to go see and tour? So we have a wide range here, but we have definitely some that got a lot more votes than others all the way through. We've got this chart, but we've got one more that shows a little better. Go ahead and go to the next one. So this has all of them on there. And the top, on a tour like that, typically you can get to 6 or 7 different parks throughout the city. You can't cover 59 or so parks that we've recommended here. But by far the most votes, 13 responses for Hemisphere Civic Park, 12 for Hardworker Park, 9 for McAllister Park, 6 for Brackenridge Park, and then 5 apiece for Lockwood Nicolichi Parks and Oak Beach Naval Park as well. So those are some of those big projects throughout the city. Now one that was also mentioned, the Old Spanish Trail, that was not in the staff recommendations, but it's another project that was shown on that green list. It's one to go look at. So what we plan to do is work with the co-chairs to kind of look at that and finalize a plan and a routing for that for the day so that we can get throughout the city and see these great parks. Okay, the other one that we had, the great thing about the interaction between meetings is we fill in emails and working with the committee, and we've had a lot of questions about a project that's kind of flown under the radar so far, and this is UIW Sports Fields. What's this all about down in Brook City base? So I thought, you know, given the attention that we've had from you all, multiple districts, I thought, well, let me just share a couple of slides on that, because we do know quite a bit of information about this project. So if you're familiar with Brook City base, down off of Interstate 37, Southeast Military, just to the south of the Southeast Military, lots of development going on, redevelopment happening here. The sports fields that are planned by UIW in coordination with Brook City base are down in this southwestern part of the area. So and then we've got a close-up of this. Let's go to the next slide. So basically what we have proposed as part of the staff recommendations is $2.8 million. The initial request from UIW and Brook City base was, or the Brooks Development Board, was $10 million. So they were looking for $10 million. We were able to work everything out. We proposed $2.8 million. So this would be a leveraged project with University of Concord. And their plan down here is soccer, tennis courts. See, this is a dozen tennis courts here, big soccer field and track, some concessions, restrooms, facilities, other sports fields here. They have a phase one plan. And basically this does, and we talked before about public access. So we've talked with UIW about that. What's the plan? Is this just for University of Concord Word, or what is it? And it's similar to the UTSA arrangement. They're very much open to, obviously the city has to have some long-term ownership, some kind of 20-year ownership of some kind. It has to be open to the public. These are going to be some, like UTSA, there would be high-quality facilities, high-quality fields, but they are definitely wanting that if they put public on there, they want public use of these facilities. So they are playing with leagues and so forth, that they'll have a scheduling system where organizations can schedule time and be there, and then also for city functions as well. So it may not be where you can just walk up there on any given day and start playing frisbee out on the field because of the high level of play that's going on there, the quality that they're looking for. But it would be accessible by leagues and by the public to come out to reserve time and use that space. So very similar to UTSA. Okay.
So I do want to make a note that we're going to have this committee discussion right after this. So, and I have a list going. So I will put you next on the list.
Okay, I think that wraps it up, co-chairs. That's just a brief feedback on where we're at, and I'm going to turn it back to you all.
Okay, so with that, thank you very much, Mike. We really appreciate the presentation. We're going to jump into committee discussion now formally. We've got 20 minutes allotted for this. And I'd like to, first, before we jump into a round robin, I'd like to make sure that all of the districts get represented in their ability to ask questions. So we're going to do, as we've done before, we're going to go around by district and make sure that each district has a question that is, that you're able to pose your question and answer, get your question answered. And then we'll open it up to the floor, and then we'll have Brian take a list and do a roster. So let's start, as we started here last time, we'll start with District 6. District 6, sorry, do you have a question that you would like to pose for Mike?
Yeah, my question is on the sheet where we have the project from last night. There's, for District 6, we have two parks on here, and none of them have ever flood triggers. Is there a representation here today that are heading out to this park? Do you have triggers for this? Or do you have triggers for this?
So we have, we've taken a stab at an estimate based on what we heard and what we know about the projects. Right, so the District 6 gated skate park, when we compare that to other skate parks and so forth, property acquisition and then the construction and so forth, that's potentially a $4 million project. And then the other one you mentioned was the Piper Meadows, right? Is that what you're talking
about? Right.
That one we're estimating roughly about $1.5 million. That's a new part.
District 7, a question.
Regarding UIW, how much storage is this number, is this regarding phase 1 and phase 2, or is it just for phase 1?
This is phase 1.
Go ahead, Commissioner.
Is there any other presentations that you want to see for other projects, or is this the last one? This is the final project for consideration?
No, we will be, as we go through our discussion, if we want to see additional presentations, we can request additional presentations.
Thank you. Mike, I was wondering, is there any one place where we can go and look up what the leverage you get on different projects? Is that on one of the charts?
Yeah, we have provided that. We can also, if it's not on the website, we'll get it up there. In the follow-up information, it's there.
Okay. Excuse me.
No, it's okay. We provide a lot of information, so I'm sure everybody can see every piece of it.
District 9, and where are we? Let's see.
Mike, we have several large projects, Brighton Ridge Park, Hemisphere, and the Botanical Gardens. Do you have an itemized list of what's going in those four or five projects?
We have, so we're not into design on some of those yet.
Right.
But we do have the basic scope information that we provided to you in the initial presentation.
Right.
We'll have to see if we've got any more specifically. There's like three or four main components of the Civic Park project that we've talked about. But if there's any specific one you want us to get further into detail, we'll see what we have on. Is there a particular one or two you want us to do that? But we've tried to provide you as much as we know today.
Well, for me, it would be Breckenridge Park and the Botanical Gardens, the Zoo Park.
We'll have Xavier give to our Parks and Recreation Director.
So the Botanical Garden, that item is for the construction of an educational and multi-use facility, something similar to Harbor Park, the Urban Ecology Gathering Hall. So it's for a complete building structure, enclosed, controlled environment. On the other one you asked on specifically was Breckenridge Park is a number of items, so the focus being on the restoration of some of the historic features, meaning some of the historic buildings that are on the property that were part of the original San Antonio Water Works, also the historic retaining walls of the river. Those are WPA project walls that were constructed and are experiencing because of the trees, roots pushing those walls, and shifting and failure of some of the walls. So the majority of the funding, or all of the funding actually, is our focus would be on restoration of those historic features.
Also, we're going to clean up the river all the way down the avenue.
That is a project that San Antonio River Authority is looking at because that is actually in the channel. And that falls under the U.S. Corps of Engineers, and it's something that is more their venue than it is the park.
Thank you, Xavier. Okay, District 10, please. Your question? Thank
you. Yes, on the unfunded park projects, how does one get their project on here? Like these groups, I understand city staff was present them all, but the reason why I ask that is there was a proposed project that didn't make a list, it hasn't been talked about. It's in regards to the Linear Creekway down by some vital creek improvements, similar to a drainage project, sort of in the same location.
Okay. Any project that we hear through this process, we're going to continue to add to this list. So even ones that are introduced tonight, for those that signed up to speak. And committee members, if there's something else you want us to look at, we'll just continue to add to this list.
Okay, great. Thank you. Oh, and one more thing. I just wanted to see how we can better.
Also, the process of getting on the list. Basically, this has been from the start of the yeah. process, everything you've heard that's new, that's not established.
Great.
But
to get funded, means you cut something else.
Yes, so this is currently unfunded, and that'll be part of the committee discussion pretty heavily. And, amongst the committees, we've talked about citizens signing up to speak for the first three meetings, and then dedicating the fourth and fifth meeting to really the committee's work. And so that, obviously, you know that's going to take a lot to get there. So, anything else?
This is a description of the District 10 McAllister Park project. Just want to make sure that we had actually separated for McAllister Park funding as well, not just the Capital League baseball team relocation. So I just want to make sure that we specify that on the list.
So the committee action that was taken at the last meeting was to separate the two, right? And we'll worry about the funding later, but we're going to separate the two so that they don't go to the same place. The Capital League and Capital Health Park.
Gotcha.
So now there are two projects, and sort out the dollars for that.
Mm-hmm. But it's just not McAllister Park, because it listed on here. I just wanted to point out. Just the Capital League, so I just wish we add that in, so it's.
So the intent of the staff information was to fund Capital Movie at McAllister Park. So that's where we show Capital Movie, but we still have that out there. Really, a lot of our discussion has been, we would like to make both of them whole. We would like to end up with $2 million for Capital Movie and $2 million for McAllister Park. And that would be a good win-win, but we have to work with the committee on how to get there.
Allison, I do understand where you're coming from, and we should address that. I know McAllister is not on the list, and I just saw that myself as well, so we'll address this matter. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Without forgetting McAllister.
Yeah, I think that's a good point.
Thank you for that. Okay, let's move across the room and go to District 1. Your question.
Thank you. I just have a general clarification question. I noticed on several of these we have the word general, we have general improvements, and yet on some of them we have to possibly include but not limited to. Would those by sound identification? Where did those come from?
So it's a couple of places. In a lot of these parks we've already been working with the community quite heavily in previous bonds and on an annual basis. So we know kind of what the next step is. So we put some ideas in there. But as we've talked before, once the voters approve the projects, then we're going to engage with the community again to say, here's what we're thinking, what are you thinking, so, to make sure we're on the same page with the community. So we don't say for sure this is going to happen, because we want to make sure there's flexibility with the community.
I just wanted to verify that they will still have a process to make people put in, but this isn't a new suggestion.
Yes, on every park project, there's full input with the community. Or
everything,
you know, it's fine.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Okay,
now District 2, question.
Yes, Mr. Grisby, thank you for your leadership on this and presenting this to us. I have it's a question that I've been settled with Mr. Gorman. Gordon came in and he talked about some issues with that part, but I noticed there's no numbers here. Are you able to provide us some numbers for these parks that don't have that information so that we can kind of have a guidance committee so we can move forward? And also, is there a way to upload a visual reality of all these parts, especially the ones that did not make this survey list, because I was not aware of the survey list. And so I would like to see some of these other parks and what they have to offer, what they're asking, how we put that presentation together. Is that possible?
Sure. So if you go to the city's homepage, sanantonio.gov, there's a link to the 2017 bond, and we have an interactive map on that site of all of the bond projects that are recommended. And then you can drill down very specifically to views of that and some scope information about the projects as well. So that is available.
I mean, this list here is additional ones.
Oh, additional ones?
That's what I'm speaking of, the additional ones. Missing numbers and also virtual reality for these parts, because I see you already have your scheduled parts. I'd like to see some of these, that these additional citizens came and asked about.
Okay, we'll look to see how to best do that. There's a variety of information. Some have been handed out. And what we can do is see what we can provide electronically so you can look at that. So we'll have to follow up and see what we can do. On the numbers, though, the ones that did not, or the entity did not, or the person didn't bring a number with them, we kind of took a stab at what we think based on the scope. So for Pippin Sullivan Park, the David Scott YMCA area, $550,000 was our kind of ballpark estimate of the scope.
So you have the numbers for all those in this?
We have an internal number that we said, okay, based on what we know, here's kind of the range of what we think we need. Right.
Thank you, sir.
Sure.
Okay, so now on to District 3, please.
Yes, I have a quick question. On this email I received on Parks and Recreation New Project and staff recommended project increase request, these projects that are on here, I don't have notes on them, but some of these were not on the staff recommended list, and now they're on the new, I guess it's a new list for a substantial amount of money. So how is this going to incorporate into the ones that are not on the, this was not on the original list. Right. So is, and who decides this? This is staff recommended. So I just wanted to know if the committee's not involved in these decisions or?
So yeah, process-wise, we started the community process with the staff recommended slate of projects, the 59 projects that we had. And then what we've done is we've been building this green list on the new projects that have been heard. So these are not necessarily the recommended, they're just information for the committee and dollar amounts associated with that and some scope information. So really now it's the committee's responsibility with us to kind of work through how many of these projects get into the recommendation that the committee has that moves forward to council. And as City Manager Ms. Kelly said, obviously you have to stay within the money. So if you're going to add something, you have to propose cutting something. So that's going to be a big part of the next meeting number four.
I understand that. Yeah, that's because the list that you gave us there doesn't have an amount, but the other list that is a new project increase or added does have an amount. So I was just wondering. Okay.
Okay, District 4, please.
Yes. I have a question about the Rainbow Hills Gymnasium. There's no amount list that I can see that, but I happen to know that when they built the community center, that they put in the foundation already so that a gymnasium could be added, and they fixed that back wall so it could be moved out so that they could have that gymnasium inside. And so I'd like to know why there's no funding that gets that for this particular project.
We did put a number to it based on what we know. And so that was $3.25 million for the gymnasium. I don't know if that took into account the existing foundation. We did, okay. So Ronnie Duke with our team says that took into account the existing foundation there. So the numbers we show in front of you are what was provided and some of them were left blank because there wasn't a number provided, but 3.25 is our estimate for that project.
Thank you. Thank you for that clarification. So it's not necessarily that we don't know the number, it's just it was not presented during the presentation that was given when the project was proposed during the testimony. Okay, thank you. All right, and for District 5, please. Question?
Oh, yes. I have a question on the San Antonio Zoo parking garage. I'm just wondering, is it, should it be in facilities? Because it's a structural thing rather than a park issue? Because it seems like it would be more of a facilities issue.
Yes, and it's in both. So this is one of the few projects that shows up in both categories. So we have some funding in the facilities because it is a parking garage facility. But we also have funding in the parks because it's going to serve Brackenridge Park and that whole area. So in the discussions, we thought, you know, it's really both. So we put it in both. It's a total of $12 million that are split into two different categories.
So
$24
million
together? No, $12 million total.
Oh, total. Thank you. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, how much time do we have, Brian? Okay, we have about 5 minutes left, so we can open up to some questions. PPAC, your hand first. Go ahead.
Thanks. Just to round it out, can we have the rest of the ones that were left off that you have a guesstimate on?
Sure. Let me provide those. I'll just start with Pitt and Sullivan again.
Yeah.
Pitt and Sullivan Park, $550,000. Stinson Park. $400,000. The Rainbow Hills Gymnasium, $3.25 million. Excuse me, District 6 Gated Skate Park, $4 million. Piper Meadows HOA New Park, $1.5 million. And then the Monticello Park, $350,000. And that again is based on the scope as we know it as we've heard.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, now. Yeah, I think part of the confusion, and I think you cleared one of the things out. In the handouts that were sent to us via email, this list had a title of it. It said Parks and Recreation, new project and staff recommended project increase request. Tonight you have the right title on it. But one of the things that you did have on here is the amount that you just listed. That was the column that was on there, and it was very helpful. And it's not on the list tonight.
Okay.
So,
I just have a quick question. What Chuck asked earlier on was which projects have leverage funds. And there is a list of the projects, but there's no dollar. So it would be helpful if we knew how much everybody was raising to help support
the project. Okay, we'll get that sent out. That may be, I'm sure it's well in advance of the next one.
Okay, Richard, you're next. You have a question? No, you do. Okay. Okay, John, Mr. Kemp.
Yeah. Mike, on the UAW, for example, on some of these leverage projects, do we have like a breakout of how much time use of those fields will be devoted to city use versus, say, UAW use? Is that based on how much the UAW and the city contribute to the project? For example, if the city contributes 20%, UAW 80%, does the city get 20% use of those fields? And is that an agreement with UAW, for example?
What we're going to be doing, John, is we're going to negotiate, and really we're looking by the end of this calendar year. Anything that's moving on from the committee, we're looking to have an agreement with the other party on those types of things to really lay that out. And so it may not be specifically just a breakdown in dollars, but we want to make sure we get the most that we can. That would be part of the negotiation.
When we
have
lobby,
is
it
Lobbyita? It's a lot of the. It's the historic plazas there that need to be restored.
Are we going to invent a new business or is your leasing to
Are we, sorry, building?
A new business? Are you taking into consideration a new business?
of needs in the Great Plaza area there. So that would be the focus.
Okay, Grace Rose, you have a question.
For instance, on the soccer field OST, because of the fact that it's like right between 1 and 7, is that one of those things that we have to put it shared? Because, you know, some of them we have, you know, that the project is shared, you know, between two districts. And because it's right there on Burton Road, it's really, I mean, 7 always considers the other side of Fred Road is 7. It was sort of, you know, and so it's sort of really difficult. Like, you know, we're looking at a project that we feel like it's in 7, but it's actually in 1. And I don't know if that's one of those kind of projects that can actually be shared.
Which project?
The OST, the soccer field. Old Spanish Road.
Oh, okay. You know, we can look at that to see where it's sited. Most of those we looked at where it's sited. Yeah. Yeah, so in a lot of cases, there's going to be a couple of districts obviously that are going to benefit from it, but we look more at something like that as to where it's sited. But at this point, really, it's not going to make that much difference because you're talking about, as a committee, $116 million. To work with. You've got staff recommendations, you've got a great list of additional possibilities here. So it's really, what does the committee want to get into that 116 and move on to city council? So whether it's a District 7 or District 1, it's probably not that big.
I know there are a couple of more questions out there, but I'm going to have to cut off now. We've got quite a few people signed up to speak this evening, and this is our last evening to hear public testimony. And we want to give them the full opportunity to speak.